Rheingold begins in the depths of the Rhine, where three alluring water nymphs are guarding a golden treasure. We enter the world of the fairy tale here, and like all fairy tales, this story is brimming with deep psychological truths. Let's begin where Wagner himself begins, with that low E flat that gets the story going. As the music flows into undulations, we find ourselves in the depths of the Rhine, a river where the unconscious is and where the story begins and unfolds. The famous E flat that got the story going has just finished sounding. This sound is meant to depict the world coming into existence like a singularity from which slowly waves of sound evolve to announce the watery depths we all come from. There's some mystery about that E flat. Wagner suggested that it came to him in a dream. Other sources claim he heard it after collapsing on the floor, feverish, ailing from a bout of food poisoning. No matter what, the beginning of this journey evokes the notion of something arising out of the unconscious depths. So now we see the three alluring water nymphs dancing about and celebrating life. Number three is significant, as it is a number we encounter often in fairy tales. It's a number of action. It implies movement and change, unlike the stodgy number two, which has a stuck feeling about it. For things to move, you need a little wrench thrown into the works. Many religious and philosophical systems count with three principles. For example, the Christian virtues of faith, hope, and love, or the gods in the Egyptian trinity of Horus, Isis, and Osiris, and Hinduism's Brahma, Vishnu, and Shiva. Now we have the water nymphs, symbols of innocence and purity, but also of immaturity. They need to grow up, and prancing around the Rhine River is unlikely to allow them to do so, no matter what they are guarding. So let's look at what they are guarding, the golden treasure. Gold in myth and in fairy tales is meant to signify the ultimate goal. As we're reading the story psychologically and seeing it as depicting one psyche, the gold represents what we are all striving to find deep within ourselves. It is our purpose. The gold is the sun, and the sun in archetypal symbolism is our life soul and life's purpose. In the context of light, gold symbolizes our search for consciousness, our individual search, and mankind's search. In comes Albrecht, the dwarf from the underworld who spots the three maidens, has lustful thoughts, approaches them, and is teased and rejected by each of the maidens in turn. Dwarfs are mythical creatures, and they symbolize the rejected and unloved side of ourselves, the parts of us that are stunted because we have not yet brought the light of awareness to them. So as Albrecht skulks off to the side, lamenting his fate, the Rhine maidens decide this is the very moment to stare at the gold that is at the bottom of the Rhine and which they're entrusted with guarding. They then declare that whoever fashions a ring from this gold will rule the world. The catch being that to fashion the ring means you must forsake love. They say this with Albrecht standing by, festering with rage and looking to mask his powerlessness with anything he can grab. Now we have to ask ourselves, why would the Rhine maidens make this declaration with Albrecht standing by if they don't want to have Albrecht steal the gold and fashion it into a ring? Of course, this is what Albrecht does. The answer is that the ring needs this thoughtless act to get consciousness going. Without it, we will be stuck on that E-flat chord forever. Nothing will grow. Think of the other great story of beginnings, Genesis. There too we have Adam and Eve walking unconscious in the walled garden until the serpent seduces Eve into eating the apple, and she in turn seduces Adam, and their eyes are suddenly open to consciousness. The act is known as a felix culpa, a happy fault, because without it, everything remains static. So the Rhine maidens must give up their gold, if for nothing else, so that they stop frolicking around and give up their life to suffering and lamentation, which is the surest way to mature. So Albrecht has stolen the gold, forged the ring, and is now ruthlessly ruling over those in the underworld or shadow world. As a smith, he is like Wagner himself, an artist of incredible talent, but who is damaged, one-sided, unable to find in his life what he developed so powerfully in his art. Now we are taken up, up above the clouds and into the land of the gods, where the head god, Wotan, lies sleeping next to his wife, Fricka. As the chief god, Wotan represents the ego consciousness. Now, Wotan is at a crucial point in his life, a liminal moment. He is on the cusp of midlife when everything falls apart in order to be rebuilt again. The moment when you wake up to the fact that you're going to die and that no one is going to save you. Now this is the moment to undertake the journey inwards. It's also the journey represented by all of our great heroic myths. The hero must take that first step on the path that will take him to the deepest part of himself, that part he is unaware of, but which is the gold that would allow him to become whole. Now, the journey is not an easy one. There are dragons to slay and minefields to sidestep, and you may not survive it, but what cost do you pay if you do not undertake it? Goethe, the German poet, would say the price is your soul. And so there is Wotan, the chief god, and what has he done on the cusp of his midlife? Well, he's built a giant castle, Valhalla, from where he can hide from the terrors of his own inner urgings. Valhalla is a great metaphor, a sports car, motorcycle, trophy wife all wrapped into one. It is significant that two giants have built it for him, simpletons with all the brute strength, but none of the emotional or intellectual sophistication to live a truly integrated life. Now, the giants symbolize that part of Wotan which is pure brawn, a needed part for sure, but not much help when you're on the cusp of a midlife descent. As such, they have led him to the medicated solution instead of the one he needs, the one that demands the insight to go into the underworld himself. Think of Odysseus, think of Aeneas, think of Moby Dick. One must descend or be condemned to the superficial life. Now to complicate things, Wotan has promised these simpletons his sister-in-law Freya as payment for their work. Now Freya is the goddess who takes care of the golden apples that help keep these hapless gods young, and without her, they're all in deep trouble. Now why would Wotan have made this ridiculous promise? Perhaps he needs to give this part of himself away so that he can undertake the journey. Perhaps he needs to give up his youthful ways. Sleeping next to Wotan as the scene opens is his wife Fricka, the goddess of hearth and home. Fricka is railing at her husband, angered that he could have promised her sister fire to the giants when she's in charge of the golden apples that keeps all of them young. Wotan has no intention to give fire to the giants, of course. In his unconsciousness, he thinks he will just outsmart the two louts and be done with it. Now in comes Loge, the demigod of fire. Fire in mythology is associated with inspiration, and you need inspiration, fire, to get things going creatively and in just about every other way. Remember the way Prometheus was tortured by the gods for having given fire to men? Fire is dangerous, just as inspiration is. It will burn you up if you don't watch it. But it will also take you to great heights, heroic heights, the heights of the gods, which is why they guard it so jealously. Now, Loge is the truly androgynous and slippy character in this cycle. He is the trickster from mythology. You can never quite figure out why he is helping one or the other character, and at some point you don't care. Loge promises to find a solution to Wotan's problem. He represents Wotan's intuitive side, and so it will be intuition that will save the day. Loge travels the world up and down and learns of Albrecht and his ring, and he thinks, aha, that is the answer. They will take the ring from Albrecht and give it to the giants instead of Freya, and things will be right in the world. So Wotan and Loge travel down to the underworld, and through their cunning and through Albrecht's arrogance, born of his insecurities and being rejected so many times, Albrecht makes a terrible mistake, which costs him the gold and the ring. He is then dragged up to the top of the world to be humiliated by the two gods. Now the scene where Albrecht is on his knees pleading for them not to take the ring is powerful. Albrecht, the dwarf, our shadow, all that we reject in ourselves, has been humbled by the two powerful gods. A part of you recoils from this. Albrecht makes a very important point now. He tells them that he's given up love for this ring, that he is condemned to live in a world without feeling for his crime, and that they, on the other hand, have done nothing but steal it with their cunning. Now, anybody should know, and especially the gods, that you can't get away with this kind of behavior. A price will have to be paid for such a theft. Albrecht curses the ring, and we know that whoever gets it is certainly going to pay, and then he retires to the underworld, the world of shadows. The problem is that Wotan has already been seduced by the ring's power. After all, what is a ring if not a fantastic symbol for wholeness, for integration, for the end goal of a life's journey? And it is also made of gold, the power of the sun, the symbol for all that is in us that makes us individuals and for the unique gifts we bring to the world. Too bad we have to mine for it. We have to pay for it, to travel through the underworld, etc. Of course, Votan can't stop thinking of the ring. Now, the giants are given all the gold Loge and Votan have stolen from Albrecht, and they insist that the gold be used to cover up every inch of Freya so the giants can't see her and can't be seduced by her. The problem is there's a little hole the size of a ring that allows them to see her eye once the gold has been placed over her, and they demand the ring to cover it up. Votan, who's been hiding it, has no choice but to hand it over, though he's now totally obsessed with it. Once in the giant's hands, the ring works its curse. One brother kills the other for it, and the one left standing turns himself into a dragon so that he can sit on it. Think of the miser and the way he sits on his money. It's the same thing. So we're at the end of Rheingold. Votan has his Valhalla, but now he longs for the ring. The Rhine maidens are still lamenting in the background, and a new day is dawning.